Praise the Lord. Thanks for coming back. Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. I love him. He's my Savior. And I'm blessed to be here in front of you. Thanks for coming back. So last video was on forgiveness and why I believe that Christians can have demons. Please, if you haven't forgive, please go back and do that. I'm trying to build up for your deliverance and teach you how to deliver other people. And without forgiveness, you just won't be delivered. There's just no two ways about it. You can't get your sins forgiven. So demons will have a legal right to you. And it's impossible. If we do push them out by power, by something, you know, by you get deliver ministry that's just based on power and I'm just going to shove that demon out of you, then there's still an open door. You know, unforgiveness is an open door and they'll just come back and most likely stronger. In the last video, we had three parts, right? Three parts that your outer courts, your inner courts, your holy of holies, your body, your soul, which includes your mind, your will, your emotions, your attitude, your heart. And then the third part is your spirit. The Holy of Holies is your spirit. Just going to throw this out to you kind of as a freebie. There's also three baptisms, and there's also three in the Trinity. So just real quickly, you get baptized into Jesus' name, and that's for the body. You're dead. You're buried with Jesus Christ. And when you raise, you're a new creation. So basically, your old flesh is buried with Jesus Christ, and then you rise, and you're a new creation. So it's kind of a form of deliverance, you know, it's basically giving you the power over your flesh and not having your flesh overpower you. that's why a lot of times come up, you know, people come up out of the water, you know, I've heard testimonies of heroin addicts that when they come out of the water, their addiction is broken automatically. And then obviously we have the baptism of the Holy Spirit, which is for the Holy of Holies, where the Spirit resides, and that gives you the power, that gives you the power of the gospel, okay? But then there's a third one, Luke 3:16. John the Baptist says, one who is coming after me, who I'm not worthy to touch his sandals, he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Okay? So fire is a good thing. It just burns away your chaff, basically, before your judgment. And so, amen, we need that. And fire is of God the Father. And I believe that it will burn the inner courts, which is your will, your attitude. I mean, just think of it, how much that would change you if the chaff is burnt from your will or your attitude. Or testimonies I've heard about people getting baptized with fire is, you know, the presence of the Lord and a wave of fire will just sweep over them. And then another wave and another wave and another wave. And all the testimonies I've heard, you know, they get to a point where, oh, this is awesome, God, what are you doing? I mean, but then it gets to a point of like they're crying out, say, please stop, you know, because they feel like they're going to get killed just because the waves of burning the chaff is just so intense. So, but they're definitely changed people. Amen. Okay, so that's just kind of freebie. I'm going to post teaching on the three baptisms down below. Please check it out. So let's go over some terms when you're talking to a deliverance minister. Or when you're talking about exorcisms or deliverances, most likely, you know, I like to use the word legal right. And as you'll know, as you'll find out in later videos, probably the next video, I'll go more into a how-to, you know, practical, you know, sit them down, you know, do they have, you know, just really pragmatic. Let's do this. but demons are like lawyers. You know, if they have a legal right to be there, then there's nothing that I can do to exercise them, to deliver you. We have to find out what that legal right is, and then we have to take away that legal right. So if you're not forgiving, then that demon has a legal right to you. And so the other term is an open door. Again, unforgiveness is an open door, allows the demon to come in your life. We need to shut those doors. That's another term you might hear. Gatekeeper, kind of the same thing. You know, I need you to be vigilant, be sober, and I'm going to go into more gatekeeper scriptures shortly, starting with Job 1. But basically being a good gatekeeper is, you know, you're being vigilant. You're being vigilant that all your doors are shut and they stay shut, you know. And then in Job 1, we're going to talk about the hedge. So it's kind of, they're all kind of the same terms. So if I say legal right, shut the door, gatekeeper, or hedge, it's basically you are keeping yourself. You are protecting your borders. Understand? These gatekeeper scriptures that I'm going to share with you, I guarantee will revolutionize your spiritual warfare. I mean, revolutionize it. So I need you to meditate on these scriptures until you break the lies that unfortunately we have, and we understand what the principle is. And I'm going to tell you this principle, and you're probably going to be upset, but I'm going to still press forward. The principle is this. If you keep yourself, meaning if you're holy, you don't sin, if you keep yourself, the enemy cannot touch you. The enemy cannot assail you, okay? So has that been your experience? Probably not. So are you going to be upset at me that I'm saying this, you know, and your flesh is rising and like, how dare you say that? Satan's always going to attack me. And that's part of the fight. That's part of the warfare. Yes, he will come at you, but touching you, assailing you personally, is two different things. And I'll show you why. So again, I can tell you what my experience is and you can tell me your experiences and we'll never grow because both of our experiences have been not based on the Word of God. It's been based on what we've been taught in the church and other experiences of our friends and family. So us getting together and telling each other what we want to hear will never change. So let me challenge you with this. These scriptures that I'm going to show you, how many hours have you meditated on scriptures that tell you that Satan can't touch you? How many hours? And then verses, how many hours have you watched horror movies? And I'm not trying to judge you, but how many hours have we spent watching demonic, occult, horror movies because we like to be scared? I'm sure the imbalance is pretty crazy. But let me tell you this. Every horror movie that we've ever seen is a sermon from the devil. I mean, let's just go through a couple movies. So we got The Exorcist, right? In the movie, the Catholics are doing their best to call on God to overtake this demon, to deliver this little girl, this poor little innocent girl. Well, what happens? They don't change her at all. The only time that the girl gets delivered is that the stupid Catholic guy takes the demon on himself. And then what happens to the Catholic guy? Well, he kills himself. End of video. You know, I mean, where's the power of God, you know? In this video, the sermon is that Satan can take whatever he wants, and there's nothing you can do about it. So that's his message that you sat and listened to for an hour and a half, 2 hours. Legion, the most recent video where Michael, the archangel, comes down and rebels against God and tries to protect an innocent baby. I mean, come on, you know? And then God is tired of the earth, and so he wants to kill the last savior, basically, of the human race. And so he's sending angels, holy angels, to possess people to go kill this innocent baby. I mean, gosh, man. Or just Paranormal Activity or these other demonic movies. There's no God in there whatsoever, right? And in fact, I think the first one, they try to fight it by getting on a Ouija board. And I'm telling you that I know these movies because I've watched them too. And, you know, I'm just kind of now realizing this myself, that most likely, you know, I'm not going to sit and get the sermon of the devil anymore. I'd rather focus on greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And I'm going to give you some amazing, amazing, amazing scriptures that seriously will revolutionize. I mean, when I give you these scriptures, you're going to go to the Bible and you're like, no way, you have to, you've totally taken these out of context. You've had to. And I'm going to show you that I haven't. And you've just been lied to. And being lied to is an open door. So if you feel like Satan can come and smack you upside the head anytime he wants to, well, Satan's going to come anytime he wants to and smack you upside the head because that's what you believe. This whole warfare is based on faith. And what is faith? A conviction of beliefs. Where those beliefs come by? Well, it comes by the hearing of the word. So if you don't know the word of God, then where's your faith coming from? It's probably coming from your horror movies. So one of the terms is a hedge. And Job 1 talks about, and if you want to stop this video and read Job 1, you know, that probably would behoove you. I'm just going to run through it. I'm not going to just do it at time. So it's Job 1 through, I think, chapter 2, probably to verse 10, I believe. So Job says, Job was perfect, upright, and avoided evil. And he was a great gatekeeper. And not only did he keep himself, but he also kept his family. He would do sacrifices just in case his family sinned while they were drinking and eating and being merry. So Satan presented himself before God. Another lie is that, you know, we're caught between Satan and God, and it's like, oh, okay, you know, and that's just not the case. Satan is defeated. He knows it. He's trying to keep you from knowing who you are in Christ. If you knew that you're an ambassador of Jesus Christ, you would know to kick his butt. So anyway, Satan comes, presents himself before God, and God said, hey, have you considered Job? So we know that after Satan going through earth and walking to and fro, Satan knew Job. So if you are doing what you need to be doing, living a holy lifestyle, fighting the kingdom, Satan is going to know you, okay? And the goal, obviously, is to be on his top 10 most wanted list, all right? So God says, hey, have you considered Job? Satan says, basically, how can I consider him? You have him hedged in. You have him hedged in. You have his home hedged in. You have everything he has, all of his belongings, all of his possessions. You have him hedged in on all sides. And he is blessed. The work of his hands are blessed. And his substance is increased in the land. So Job is a blessed man. He is being a good gatekeeper. His doors are shut. No demons have legal right to him. And he is flourishing. Amen? And that's our portion. So Satan gets permission to go touch Job. And what Satan looks like is that the Sabians is like a band of people that come and steal the oxen and the donkeys. Fire fell of God from heaven. And I looked up God, and it meant the one true God. And that burnt the sheep. The Chaldeans stole the camels and killed the servants. And then finally, there was a great wind that blew down the house and killed his children. So Satan, in the physical realm, looked like two groups of people that came and stole and robbed and killed. And then also looked like a great wind. Okay, so maybe when Jesus Christ was on the boat and he calmed the storms and rebuked the winds, maybe he wasn't talking to nature. Maybe he was talking at the demons behind the nature, and maybe the storm was trying to kill the disciples and Jesus. Who knows? Again, speculation, but again, here we see that Satan was the wind, or caused the wind. So Job passed his test, and he didn't sin or curse God. And then Satan came back and said, okay, well, if he touches skin or his flesh, then he'll curse you. I guarantee it. And so God gave him permission, okay? Because this whole time, Job hasn't sinned. So Job hasn't punched a hole in his own hedge, okay? He hasn't opened the door to any demons, and he's been a good gatekeeper still. And so Satan still needs to get permission because Job hasn't given him permission. Amen? So Satan goes out, and on the physical realm, what does it look like? Well, it's boils. Well, if Job went to the doctor nowadays, they'll be like, yeah, take these antibiotics, and it's because of this, and you must have got a virus, and all this nonsense. But in all actuality, it's Satan who's caused the boils. The story, I want to show you that God hedged him in, okay, because Job was perfect, upright, and avoided evil, and so therefore he was protected. Could Satan get to him before he got permission from God? No. So all of his stuff, you know, his household, him, his house, all of his belongings were protected. And the enemy could not touch him. Amen. So here's some more gatekeeper scriptures. I'll be right back. Okay, 1 John 5:1, let's define who is born of God. Whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. 1 John 5:18, we know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not, but he that is begotten of God keepeth himself, and that wicked one toucheth him not. Okay, this is one of my favorite verses, so please go to the chapter 5, see if I'm taking this out of context. 1 Peter 5:8, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. Be on guard. Luke 10:17-20, and the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. And he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Notwithstanding in this rejoice not, that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. Amen. Ephesians 6, above all, taking the shield of faith, right? Faith is what makes us go around. Wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, praying always with all prayer and supplication of the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. So Luke 22:31-32, and the Lord said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan hath desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for thee, that thy faith fail not, and when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren. So Jesus Christ knows that Satan wants to sift Peter, but Jesus Christ doesn't say, don't worry, Peter, I'll protect you. He doesn't say that. He says, I'll pray for your faith. So you see this consistent line throughout this whole gatekeeper lesson is that it is your faith. You know, the shield of faith will extinguish the fiery darts, all of them. Okay. So if you don't have faith, it's not going to do you any good to get up in the morning and say, you know, in the name of Jesus Christ, I put on the shield of faith. I put on the belt of truth. If you don't know truth, or if you're believing a lie, that thing that you do doesn't mean anything. And it's kind of, you know, I'm trying not to bash on your guys' traditions, but anyways, it's by faith. It's also awesome too in verse 32 that Jesus Christ already knows that Peter's going to deny him three times. But he says, when thou art converted, or that means reformed, or, you know, you turn back morally, strengthen thy brethren. So Jesus is saying, I'm going to pray for your faith. I know you're going to fail, but I also know that you're going to get back up. So when you're reformed, come back and strengthen the brethren. So there's three things here that is kind of interesting. Other thoughts about being a good gatekeeper. Do not be hypnotized. Okay. If you've ever been one of those shows, I mean, they're telling you, relax, relax, you know, it's basically, I mean, they're hypnotizing you into a state of basically giving up your gatekeeper duties. And what you do is you're going up there and you're willingly saying, I don't know you, you're some stranger, but this is fun. So I'm going to give you the keys, you know, I'm going to allow you to take over my gatekeeper duties. And so that's what happens, you know. You guys might be amazed at what happens during hypnotist acts, but I believe it's totally spiritual. And if you come away with a demon, I would not be the least surprised, because you're basically saying, I don't know you from Adam, but you want to take over my gatekeeping duties? Okay. Oh, relax. Okay, deep breaths. I mean, it's the same meditation techniques that is going on. And so another thing is yoga, meditation, Eastern religion. You know, deep breaths, just release yourself, you know, feel yourself going, you know, all this stuff. And, you know, if you see a spirit guide, follow him, you know, I mean, gosh, what a horrible gatekeeper you are. Okay. Stop doing that. Be vigilant, be sober. You're the one, you know, again, Satan wants to sift you. I'm going to pray for your faith that you are able to stand. Okay. Not take deep breaths and relax and let go and let whoever wants to take over, take over. I mean, come on, guys. Pot or drugs, that's another thing. Here you go, chemical substance. Please take over my gatekeeping duties. I don't have too many friends that smoke pot, but the ones that I do know, at least two of them have epilepsy now, like out of nowhere. And so it's because they're giving themselves over to... they're releasing their gatekeeper duties. And I believe the epilepsy is a demon. You know, and granted, there's grace for these things. But if you're on the front lines and you're a threat to the enemy will use every advantage he can. Another gatekeeper thing that I want to talk to you about is 1 Timothy 5:22. Paul tells Timothy, lay hands suddenly on no man, neither be partaker of other men's sins, keep thyself pure. So, are those things connected? I mean, there's a revival in Florida, and I'm not going to talk bad about anybody because I personally don't know. I wasn't there. But, I mean, you just got to look at the fruit afterwards, you know. I've seen personally, you know, major speakers will come through church, and you kind of assume, well, because the pastor allowed that person to be in church, he must be okay. Again, you're giving up your own gatekeeper duties to your pastor, and that's not biblical. So when the when this great speaker, popular person says, "Hey, come on down, and I'm gonna give you my giftings," people just sprint on down the line, you know, and I gotta be careful. But on the same token, how many people do you believe, you know, prayed in the name of Jesus Christ? You know, I do not receive anything that is not holy. I only receive what is holy, and Lord, what you want for me. I don't think many people. Let me open myself up to whatever you want to give me. And nobody has any idea what this guy's doing, who this guy is, what he does in secret. The 1 John 4 test every spirit. That's not going on in our churches, folks. And so you're running ahead. And if Paul's telling 1 Timothy not to lay hands suddenly on any man, then shouldn't that apply to us too? Don't allow man to, you know, suddenly lay hands on us either, you know, like. Anyways, the person who is head of the Florida revival, you know, he was basically having an affair in the middle of it. And there's a lot of weird stuff that came out of it. And even him, he's on tape saying, I'm even surprised that this anointing is traveling so fast and so quickly. And you see videos of, you know, them falling out and all that stuff. And then they take it back to their churches and them falling out and whatever. I really don't want to focus on the manifestations. If you're acting like a snake, then I'll focus on the manifestations. And, you know, it's called Kundalini or a serpent, you know, spirit. And those are common. But I'm not going to judge God. But we can judge is the fruit afterwards. You know, are you a better Christian than you were before? And unfortunately, a lot of people aren't. And a lot of people have bondage since then. So, again, that's just, I know it's a very sensitive subject. You know, I'm not going to blast, you know, the moves of the Holy Spirit, you know, and a lot of them start out pure, you know, and Satan sees that a lot of people get healed, delivered, and saved and stuff. So he'll come in and invert it. So just be a good gatekeeper, guys. 1 John 4, test everything. And it's your faith. It's your faith that meditate on these scriptures about being a good gatekeeper. And, you can't please God without faith and the shield of faith. And so I'm going to throw you a little curveball. And to be even a better gatekeeper, let's go to Jude 24:25. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and ever. Amen. So to be even a better, excellent gatekeeper, you know, guard against sin, but rest in the King, rest in his spirit. You know, the joy of the Lord is my strength. You know, it can be tiresome, you know, if you think it's just all on your shoulders, you know, you're just like all the time, like, okay, you know, where's a demon? You know, and don't do that. You know, demons aren't under every nook and cranny. If you spill coffee on your shirt, it's not a demon, you know. So there's that opposite extreme too. And I'm getting a lot of comments, you know, like, you know, so you think we have to have demons to sin? No. You know, we're evil. We deserve death. You know, we all fall short of the glory of God. But when we do open the doors, demons come in and strengthen that sin. So when we do repent, a lot of times we're still addicted to things. And it's because we haven't shut the door and then kicked the demon out. Okay? God bless you. Look below. I'm going to, when somebody comes to me and says, hey, I need deliverance, I usually give them a questionnaire to fill out. And so you can go look through that questionnaire. At the end, it has some symptoms of a demonized Christian, you know, maybe 8 or 9 on the scale of 1 to 10. Also, I'm going to list the prayers. So, you know, the forgiveness and what do you need to look through your house? You know, go throughout your house. You know, any frogs, any owls, any dragons, any skulls, any things of death, you know, any satanic items, any cursed items, you know, pray the Holy Spirit, any movies, any music, all that stuff needs to be cleared out of your home because that too is a legal right. And, you know, I'll go over the questionnaire with you. The next video, I'll go over with the prayers with you, and I'll show you scripture why I just said frogs and owls and dragons. Those are all biblical demons. Okay, we're on the home stretch. This video is a little longer than anticipated, but it was needed. Meditate on the scriptures. Stop watching horror flicks. Stop getting sermons from the devil. I love you. Keep yourself, right? Keep yourself holy. The enemy cannot touch you if you do that. All right? Will we be persecuted? Yeah, but for our faith, you know? God bless you. I pray that the bone falls to the ground and the meat goes straight into your soul, into your spirit. I love you and see you soon.